Welcome to Behind the Red Curtain at Tampa Theatre. I'm Jill Witecki, the theater's director of marketing. Summer at Tampa Theatre is really special. It's the time of year we bring some of the greatest movies ever made back to the big screen. This year's Summer Classic Movie Series features films that span seven timeless decades and feature actors that are still very familiar to us today. Legends like Douglas Fairbanks Sr., Julie Andrews, Ginger Rogers, and Cary Grant. Stay tuned. In just a moment, I'll tell you a little bit about each of the films that makes up the Summer Classic Movie Series, happening here this summer at Tampa's favorite movie palace. Welcome to the show. Our first film forever changed the science fiction film genre. Set in a futuristic dawn of the new millennium, 2001: A Space Odyssey follows a team of scientists sent into space to explore a 4-million-year-old monolith discovered on the surface of the moon and determine what alien life forms could be watching Earth. Based on a novel by Arthur C. Clarke, the strikingly stylized film by Stanley Kubrick has become one of the most often referenced films in cinematic history, influencing generations of filmmakers and films, including this year's Oscar Best Picture nominee, Gravity, as well as another one of our summer classics films, Saturday Night Fever, in which the dance club is named 2001 Odyssey. Revered for award-winning special effects like the psychedelic Stargate sequence and haunting visuals like Hal's unblinking red eye, 2001 is just as recognized for its innovative sound design. There is no dialogue in the first 25 minutes of the movie, nor in the last 23 minutes. And aside from the film's music, which represents both original pieces like the famous opening theme and classic standards like the Blue Danube, no sound at all is heard when the characters are out in the silent vacuum of space. And though the American Film Institute ranked it number 15 on its list of the greatest movies of all time, and number 1 among the 10 greatest sci-fi films, 2001's reception when it debuted in 1968 was almost as cold as the stratosphere itself. In the premiere screening of the film, 241 people walked out of the theater. It was not a financial success during its opening weeks, and MGM was planning to pull it out of theaters completely. But they were persuaded to stay the course by cinema owners who had seen increasing numbers of young adults attending the film. Perhaps the story's author, Arthur C. Clarke, said it best. If you understand 2001 completely, we failed. We wanted to raise far more questions than we answered. 2001: A Space Odyssey is rated G and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, June 1st. Tampa Bay Times film critic Steve Persall will lead a short discussion of the film immediately after the screening. Our next film is the classic coming-of-age story of a young girl nicknamed Scout and her father, Atticus Finch. Finch is a white attorney defending a black man against rape charges in Depression-era Alabama, but the prejudiced townspeople would just as soon lynch the accused man than see him come to justice. Based on Harper Lee's Pulitzer Prize-winning book, To Kill a Mockingbird is ranked number 2 in the American Film Institute's list of the most inspiring movies of all time. Atticus Finch was voted the top screen hero of the past 100 years. After being offered the part, Gregory Peck read Harper Lee's novel in one sitting and accepted the role immediately. Atticus was modeled after Lee's own father, Amasa Lee, an attorney whose 1923 defense of a black client inspired the novel's trial. Harper Lee was a guest on the set the day that Peck's first scene was shot, in which his children run up to greet him. Peck noticed Lee crying after the scene was filmed, and she explained that Peck had looked just like her late father, that he even had a little round pot belly just like her dad's. "That's not a pot belly, Harper," Peck told her. "That is great acting." Peck met Amasa Lee, who was 82 years old by then, and formed a strong bond with the man. And when Amasa died during filming, Harper gave Peck her father's watch and chain. Peck was proudly wearing that same watch and chain at the Academy Awards when he won the Oscar for Best Actor. To Kill a Mockingbird is unrated and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, June 8th. Tampa Bay Times film critic Steve Persall will lead a short discussion of the film immediately after the screening. It's 1977. Disco is at its peak, and 19-year-old Tony Manero lives to be the king of the dance floor at 2001 Odyssey. Outside the club, though, things aren't so hot. Tony consistently fights with his father and doesn't like his dead-end job at the paint store. But when he meets Stephanie and starts training with her for the club's dance competition, his dreams of a big city life beyond Brooklyn change Tony's outlook and plans for the future. In what has become one of many defining roles in his career, John Travolta took his portrayal of Tony very seriously. He ran 2 miles and danced for 3 hours each day to get in shape for Saturday Night Fever, dropping more than 20 pounds in the process. He worked so hard to get the choreography for You Should Be Dancing perfect that he threatened to quit the film when the studio suggested it should be shot close up instead of full body. The movie was originally titled Tribal Rights of the New Saturday Night, after the New York Magazine article that inspired it. Then it was shortened to Saturday Night as a direct reference to Tony's social calendar. But when the Bee Gees submitted the soundtrack, the song Night Fever embodied the film's spirit so perfectly that the title changed again. That soundtrack album sold more than 20 million copies, making it the top-selling album in history, until the record was shattered by Michael Jackson's Thriller 6 years later. Saturday Night Fever is rated R and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, June 15th. This screening is sponsored by Arthur Murray Tampa Dance Centers, who will be doing a dance demonstration on stage before the film. And USF film professor Harriet Deer will lead a short discussion immediately after the screening. Our next film has been a family favorite for generations, and Tampa Theatre invites you to sing along during two very special screenings of Mary Poppins. The beloved, practically perfect nanny brings a breath of fresh air into the stuffy Banks household when she is blown in from the east one afternoon. And though she initially comes to take care of the children, she ends up teaching the entire Banks family a life lesson or two with help from her chimney sweep pal, Bert. At its heart, Mary Poppins is a movie about the magic of youth and the young at heart. And though much of the magic had to be helped along with wires to make the family fly or post-production animation to bring to life the more fantastical characters, some of Mary's tricks weren't revealed to her young charges in advance, making their on-screen reactions quite real. For example, Jane's dumbfounded look when Mary Poppins takes item after item out of her carpet bag, and her little scream when Mary Poppins gives them medicines of different colors, were genuine.
I don't want it. I'm not.
But the true magic of Mary Poppins was due in large part to the energy its two stars brought to the screen. Walt Disney cast Julie Andrews for the lead after seeing her in Camelot on Broadway. When Dick Van Dyke read the script, he'd already been cast as Bert, but found the part of Mr. Dawes Sr. so hysterical that he lobbied Walt Disney for the role, even offering to play it for free. And once he got it, he set about making the small role a showstopper. The scene where Mr. Dawes has trouble negotiating the step in the Banks meeting room was not originally in the script. But when Walt Disney saw Van Dyke entertaining his castmates with some old comedic routines between takes, he requested that crew members build a 6-inch riser on the boardroom set so Dick can do that stepping down bit. And no one told the children that it was the lovable Dick Van Dyke doing double duty as the crotchety Mr. Dawes. So they were worried that the horrible old man was going to fall down and die at any moment. When it was released in 1964, Walt Disney regarded Mary Poppins as one of the crowning achievements of his career. It was, at the time, the most expensive film produced by the Disney studios, but it also became the top-grossing film of 1965 and the top-grossing Disney film for more than 20 years. Mary Poppins is rated G and will be shown at 3 p.m. Saturday and Sunday, June 21st and 22nd. Guests are invited to come dressed as their favorite Mary Poppins character or in a film-inspired outfit and participate in a costume parade on stage immediately before this special sing-along version of the film. During the movie, the song lyrics will appear on the screen and audience participation is highly encouraged. For the second consecutive year, Tampa Theatre invited our friends and fans to help pick the next movie. 692 titles were nominated, and the top three were put to a vote on Facebook. The winner will have you grabbing your leather jacket and bullwhip Harrison Ford is Indiana Jones, a famous adventurer hired by the government to locate the Ark of the Covenant before the Nazis do in Raiders of the Lost Ark. Over the course of four films, Indiana Jones has become one of Ford's most famous roles, second only, perhaps, to Han Solo. But he was not the only actor considered to wear the famous fedora. Others approached about playing the part included Nick Nolte, Sam Neill, Tom Selleck, Steve Martin, Jeff Bridges, and Jack Nicholson. Ford was cast less than 3 weeks before principal photography began. Much easier to cast was Indiana Jones's hat, which came from the famous Herbert Johnson hat shop in Savile Row, London. Costume designer Deborah Nadulman said that in order to properly age the hat, she grabbed and twisted it, and then she and Harrison Ford both sat on it until it eventually looked like a very lived-in and well-loved hat. The brim was specifically shaped to cover his eyes for protection and to help hide faces when stunt doubles were used. Speaking of doubles, many of the film's actors show up more than once. Ford's own stunt doubles also appeared as German soldiers, and renowned British wrestler Pat Roach actually gets killed twice in the film, once as a giant Sherpa left in the burning bar in Nepal, and once as the German mechanic chewed up by the plane propeller. But perhaps the most famous of the film's 67 deaths wasn't even in the script. When faced with a flamboyant swordsman, Indy was supposed to use his whip to get the swords out of the attacker's hands. But food poisoning had struck most of the cast and crew, and Ford was too sick to perform the stunt. After several unsuccessful tries, he suggested, quote, "just shoot the sucker." Director Steven Spielberg loved the idea, and the resulting scene was all the more memorable for it. Raiders of the Lost Ark is rated PG and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, June 29th. In our next film, Manhattan advertising executive Roger Thornhill finds himself mistakenly identified as a government agent by a group of foreign spies. But when Thornhill tries to straighten things out, he is framed for murder and goes on the run from the authorities. The classic Hitchcock thriller North by Northwest celebrates its 55th anniversary this year. And just like Eva Marie Saint's duplicitous character Eve Kendall, many things in the film aren't what they seem. For example, director Alfred Hitchcock couldn't get permission to film at the United Nations building. Instead, he filmed Roger Thornhill's entrance into the UN from across the street with a hidden camera. In the film, you can see the man he passes at the top of the stairs do a double take when he recognizes actor Cary Grant. Hidden camera footage was also taken of the interior of the building, and the rooms were later recreated on a soundstage for filming. Hitchcock also wasn't allowed to shoot an attempted murder on a national monument, so the Mount Rushmore scenes were also filmed in the studio on a replica of the famous presidential carvings. Everything is shot very carefully, so as to avoid associating the faces of the monument with the violence. The scenes where the crop duster is chasing and shooting at Thornhill were filmed with a real plane, but the scene where the plane crashes into the fuel truck was done using large models of both the truck and the plane. Even the South Dakota woods weren't real. Rather than going to the expense of shooting the real thing, Alfred Hitchcock planted 100 ponderosa pines on an MGM soundstage to achieve the right look. One scene that was shot on location, however, was the train station sequence, which was filmed in New York City's Grand Central Terminal. Among the onlookers watching, a famous future director who, like Hitchcock, would be known for his terror and suspense, George A. Romero. North by Northwest is not rated and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, July 6th. USF film professor Harriet Deer will lead a short discussion of the film immediately after the screening. Our next film, which is celebrating the 80th anniversary of its release, played here at Tampa Theatre in 1934 and features one of the most famous dance duos in cinematic history. The Gay Divorcée stars Ginger Rogers as Mimi Glossop, who has traveled to England to divorce her husband by staging an adulterous relationship. But when her lawyer forgets to arrange for private detectives to catch the couple, Mimi gets mixed up with an American dancer played by Fred Astaire. Fresh off the success of their previous film, Flying Down to Rio, the year before, Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers' follow-up project was supposed to have been called Radio City Revels. But when RKO Studios staff writer stalled coming up with ideas to fit the title, someone suggested filming an adaptation of Cole Porter's stage hit instead, since Astaire had already played in both the Broadway and London versions. Eric Rhodes, who plays Tanetti in the film, was also repeating his stage role from the Broadway production. And though this film became the second of a 10-picture partnership for Fred and Ginger, Astaire was reluctant to make a second movie with the woman to whom his career would be forever tied. He had previously been part of a dance duo with his sister, Adele, but really wanted to establish himself as a solo dancer. When he was offered the role of Guy Holden, Astaire sent a note to his agent about Rogers. "I don't mind making another picture with her, but as for this team idea, it's out," he wrote. "I've just managed to live down one partnership, and I don't want to be bothered with any more." But when the critics praised the pair in Rio, Astaire was persuaded. The Gay Divorcee went on to be the first film to win an Academy Award for Best Original Song for The Continental, an 18-minute song and dance sequence that proves exactly why Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers are such a legendary pair. The Gay Divorcee is not rated and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, July 13th. This screening is sponsored by Arthur Murray Tampa Dance Centers, who will be doing a short dance demonstration on stage before the film. And USF film professor Harriet Deer will lead a short discussion immediately after the screening. Our next film celebrates one epic achievement from a legendary actor we lost late last year. In Lawrence of Arabia, Peter O'Toole plays Thomas Edward Lawrence in the true story of a complex man called everything from hero to charlatan, who blazed his way to glory in the Arabian desert, then sought anonymity as a common soldier under an assumed name. The idea of filming T.E. Lawrence's life had been floating around for decades before this film came to fruition. Lawrence himself allegedly approached producers about it as far back as 1926. It was T.E.'s brother and the executor of his will, A.E. Lawrence, who eventually sold the story rights. But A.E. wasn't keen on the resulting film's representation of his family, so he wouldn't allow filmmakers to use T.E.'s autobiography title, Seven Pillars of Wisdom, when they released Lawrence of Arabia in 1962. The film spent 2 years in pre-production before shooting for 14 months in locations like Jordan, Spain, and Morocco. Soldiers from the Moroccan army were employed as extras without pay, which they understandably resented. Some took pot shots at cast and crew between takes. Others deserted the set and never came back. King Hussein of Jordan also lent an entire brigade of his Arab Legion as extras for the film. Hussein frequently visited during filming and became enamored of a young British secretary on set, who became his second wife. Less authentic than the extras were Peter O'Toole's camel riding skills. To ease his bruised backside, he added a layer of sponge rubber under his saddle, an innovation quickly adopted by some of the Bedouin tribesmen featured in the desert location shots. During the camel-intensive Aqaba scene, O'Toole was nearly killed during the first take when a gun used to signal the beginning of the scene went off prematurely. O'Toole's camel panicked and threw him to the ground as the extras' horses began charging. Fortunately, O'Toole's camel stayed still and stood over him, saving him from being trampled. In an appearance on The Tonight Show with Jay Leno years later, O'Toole confessed that, out of fear of falling off again, he and co-star Omar Sharif decided to drink heavily and tie themselves to the saddles before shooting continued. Peter O'Toole claims he never viewed the completed film until nearly 2 decades after the original release, by which time he was highly impressed. So was Premiere Magazine, which ranked this the number one performance of all time. Lawrence of Arabia is rated PG and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, July 20th. What do you get when you cross Mel Brooks with a classic Western? One of the most hilariously irreverent parodies of all times, celebrating its 40th anniversary this year. Our next film, Blazing Saddles. When the sheriff of Rock Ridge is killed, corrupt political bigwig Hedley Lamarr gets ex-con Bart appointed as the first black sheriff of an all-white town in hopes that the resulting pandemonium will leave the small town open for a takeover. The film was originally called Black Bart, but director Mel Brooks wasn't satisfied with the title and changed it when Blazing Saddles came to him, he claims, in the shower. Principal photography was already complete, however. So when Harvey Korman's Hedley Lamarr character purchases a ticket at the Grauman's Chinese Theater box office, you can see the original title in the poster case in the background. For a film that draws the bulk of its humor from racial tension, public drunkenness, and bodily functions, it's no surprise that the making of Blazing Saddles was not without controversy. During production, a studio executive stopped Mel Brooks in the elevator at the Warner Brothers lot and told him that several scenes were offensive and needed to be cut in order for the picture to be released. Brooks nodded and agreed, even though he had no intention of changing a thing. He had final cut written into his contract and, in fact, never cut a single scene except for one line between Bart and Madeleine Kahn's Lily von Stupp. After the room is darkened and Lily exclaims, "It's true, it's true," Bart had one more line that, in the end, was deleted. And how do you end a movie within a movie that blurs the lines between factual filmmaking and its fictional plot? With a guy who's not actually in the movie, of course. During the scene where the whole group is running out of the Warner Brothers studio's front gates, look for a man in a sweater watching the action. Mel Brooks has said that the man was not part of the movie, that he had simply wandered into the scene and they shooed him away to film. The guy comes back into the shot and can be seen standing next to a light pole as the characters stream past him down the street. Blazing Saddles is rated R and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, July 27th. USF film professor Harriet Deer will lead a short discussion of the film immediately after the screening. Our next movie made the song Time of My Life a wedding standard in the fall of 87, and made girls my age long to leap into Patrick Swayze's arms. Dirty Dancing tells the story of young, innocent Frances Baby Houseman, who, while spending the summer with her family in the Catskills, falls for the resort dance instructor Johnny Castle and eagerly becomes his novice, both in dance and in love. And while the final scene between Johnny and Baby has become iconic, some of the film's most memorable scenes were little more than happy accidents during production. For example, the famous scene where Johnny and Baby crawl towards each other on the floor while practicing wasn't in the script. Actors Jennifer Grey and Patrick Swayze were just messing around while warming up to do the scene, but the director liked it so much, he kept it in the final cut. Likewise, when Baby keeps laughing as Johnny runs his arm down hers, Grey's laughter was real, and Swayze's frustration was genuine. And while a lot of their choreography may have been improvised, their dance skills certainly weren't. In 1975, Grey's legendary father, Joel Grey, starred in a very short-lived Broadway musical, Good Time Charlie, about the son of Charlemagne. One of the ensemble dancers, according to the Playbill program for the show, was Patrick Swayze. Dirty Dancing screenwriter Eleanor Bergstein said that the characters of Baby and Johnny were both influenced by her own biography. Like Baby Houseman, Bergstein came from a liberal Jewish family who visited Catskills resorts during the 1960s. Her father was a doctor, and she was nicknamed Baby until she was 22 years old. Like Johnny Castle, Bergstein herself was a skilled dirty dancer who learned at house parties and later became an Arthur Murray instructor. Dirty Dancing is rated PG-13 and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, August 3rd. This screening is sponsored by Arthur Murray Tampa Dance Centers, who will be doing a short dance demonstration on stage before the film. And USF film professor Harriet Deer will lead a discussion immediately after the screening. Our next movie has been ranked one of the greatest films of all times on several industry lists, and also ultimately answers the question, who or what is Rosebud? Millionaire newspaper tycoon Charles Foster Kane has passed away, and a group of reporters are trying to make sense of his dying word, Rosebud. In a series of flashbacks, the rise and fall of Kane is revealed, along with how his wealth and power ultimately isolated the icon in his castle-like refuge. Orson Welles was just 25 years old when he directed, co-wrote, starred in, and produced Citizen Kane, his very first feature film. During the scene where Kane first buys his newspaper and delivers the line about going bankrupt in 60 years, Orson Welles appears to be dressed as himself at his actual age. Welles later claimed in interviews that he was even more made up to play a young man than he was an old one, relying on temporary facelifts and hairstyling, as well as camera tricks to make him look much more handsome than he actually was. Wells said that he spent years living down how far he'd come down from his youthful looks, when, in fact, he never really looked that good. Incidentally, for the later scenes featuring an older Kane, Wells was in the makeup chair at 2:30 every morning to be ready for a 9 a.m. start. Wells always claimed that Citizen Kane was not a biography of one specific individual, but a composite of characters from that era in America. But it is generally accepted to be a bold lampoon of real-life newspaper mogul William Randolph Hearst, who was so angered by the film that he accused Orson Welles of being a communist in order to keep the film from being released. When that didn't work, Hearst forbade any advertisement of Citizen Kane or any of RKO's movies in any of his newspapers and offered to buy the negative from the studio head George Schaefer with the intent of destroying it. Fortunately, Welles had already previewed the film to influential industry representatives who gave it rave reviews, so it was granted a limited theatrical release. Critics from non-Hearst newspapers couldn't say enough in praise of the film. Despite all the publicity, though, the film was a box office flop and was quickly consigned to the RKO vaults. At 1941's Academy Awards, Citizen Kane was actually booed every time one of its 9 nominations was announced. It wasn't until the film's re-release to the public in the mid-50s that it began building the popularity and acclaim that it enjoys today. Citizen Kane is not rated and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, August 10th. Local film expert Bob Ross will lead a short discussion of the film immediately after the screening. Our next film has been a Summer Classics mainstay for years. It fills Tampa Theatre every time we show it. So this year, we've decided to include 2 screenings of Casablanca in our series. Nightclub owner Rick Blaine discovers his old flame Ilsa is in town with her husband, Victor Laszlo. Torn between love and virtue and with the Germans on his tail, Rick, who's played by Humphrey Bogart, must choose between his feelings for Ilsa and helping Laszlo escape the Moroccan city of Casablanca to continue his fight against the Nazis. Casablanca is probably one of the most often quoted movies in cinematic history. Lines like Humphrey Bogart's, "Here's looking at you, kid," "We'll always have Paris," and "Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship," remain part of our everyday vernacular even more than 70 years after the film's release. But did you know that perhaps the most famous quote from the movie isn't actually said in the movie? The line, "Play it again, Sam," never actually appears in the film. What Rick actually says is, "You played it for her, you can play it for me. If she can take it, I can take it, so play it." And Ingrid Bergman's character Ilsa adds, "Play it, Sam, play as time goes by." No matter what was said to him, though, Sam couldn't have played it anyway. The actor, Dooley Wilson, was a professional drummer who faked playing the piano for Casablanca. But because the music was recorded at the same time as the film, the piano part was performed by Elliot Carpenter, who played behind a curtain nearby, so Dooley could watch and copy his hand movements. In 2012, that piano where Sam sat to play as time goes by sold for more than $600,000 at auction, more than 2/3 of the original budget to make the film.
No matter what the future brings, as time goes by.
Sam, I thought I told you never to play.
Casablanca is rated PG and will be shown at 3 p.m. Saturday, August 16th and Sunday, August 17th. Local film expert Bob Ross will lead a short discussion of the film immediately after the Sunday screening. Our final film in the series takes Tampa Theatre back to its silent film roots. The Black Pirate, starring Douglas Fairbanks Sr., was actually the second movie ever to be shown here back in 1926 and serves as a proud reminder of the theater's 87-year history of sharing great films with the Tampa community. When a ship is looted by rival pirates, a survivor known as the Black Pirate washes ashore and takes over the crew that ultimately ends up killing his father. Trouble stirs when a princess is discovered on board, and there is a fierce fight to save her life and protect her virtue. Although many people think black and white when they think of movies from the 20s, The Black Pirate was originally released in color. The 2-strip Technicolor print was actually 2 strips of dyed film, cemented together and run through the projector at the same time. Though effective, the method presented plenty of problems for untrained projectionists who weren't used to the double-thick film. If screened improperly, the strips would warp and stretch. And due to the expense of printing and Technicolor at this time, these issues forced the Fairbanks studio to also issue a black and white version as well. But rest assured, the version you will see here at Tampa Theatre was not colorized after the fact, as some old black and white films are. What you are seeing is exactly as director Albert Parker intended it. The Black Pirate is not rated and will be shown at 3 p.m. Sunday, August 24th. This silent, swashbuckling adventure will be accompanied by an original musical score written and performed live by renowned theatrical organist Dr. Stephen Ball on Tampa Theatre's Mighty Wurlitzer Theater Organ. Thanks for joining me here on Behind the Red Curtain at Tampa Theatre. I hope to see you and your family at Tampa's grandest movie palace for the Summer Classics movie series. On behalf of the Tampa Theatre team, I'm Jill Witecki. Thanks, and welcome to the show.